spearheading it for the Madison camp, and we actually kind of have that here. Brad Nelson's camp is his brother, obviously. Cecchetti's camp is Sam Black's, the Madison crew. We're underway here in the finals of Grand Prix Miami. Baumeister with just a forest. Cecchetti is going to start by sacrificing a windswept heath. He'll likely be searching for a forest, and that means we'll probably have an Elvish Mystic on the way.
Uncontested Whisperwood Elemental is the card to look out for here. It looks like Daniel with a Elvish Mystic here, so he has some mana acceleration, another land, and Whisperwood Elemental already in play. So if he can get to that card ahead of schedule, and Corey is without his own copy or without a Banishing Light, as we mentioned before, the game is capable of ending very quickly.
Corey going to sacrifice a Windswept Heath here, get a Plains, see if he has some acceleration or will he be going the Fleece Main Lion route. This is not really the matchup where you want to play Fleece Main Lion turn two. I think you need to have acceleration here.
Yeah.
There's Sylvan Carry added.
What goes on in this matchup dwarfs the power of a 3-3 for two or a 4-4 indestructible for five down the road by such a degree that Fleece Main Lion just doesn't really do very much. It can be valuable in the spots where the game really stalls out. It could be a valuable blocker against enormous creatures. That was something we did see in the Sam Black versus Michael Majors match, but it's not a card you're looking for early on.
Got to agree. So Baumeister does have acceleration there, and Sylvan Carry added. We'll head Cecchetti's way. There is a temple. Take a look at the top card. Top card looks like it's going to be staying on top. No, now we'll move to the bottom. So Cecchetti not loving what he saw there. Does have an Elvish Mystic here and another one there. So a lot of acceleration, and he has Whisperwood Elemental in hand.
Yeah, this is the turn three draw. This is what you're looking for.
Windswept Heath. Baumeister down to 18. There's a forest.
Now, if both players have Whisperwood Elemental, then Pelucranos plus a lot of mana or Banishing Light become the swing cards.
Yep. A little bit of acceleration there, Voyaging Satyr, and a little beater there in Fleece Main Lion. And as we mentioned, Fleece Main Lion, not really the right matchup for it.
No.
It's Whisperwood time now. That'll bring a manifest along with it. And Cecchetti can run away with the game here pretty quickly. Depending on how these manifest triggers do go. Now Corey has one of his own.
All right. So settle in.
Yep.
This is the type of opening that leads to a very long game.
Corey will manifest too. No good attacks to be had, obviously. Now, Cecchetti prepared to draw a card. Now, he does have two copies of Master of the Unseen in his hand. And now, the Teamer Sabretooth.
Okay. So, no impact with that just now, but that's a valuable component to keep in mind in the event that Daniel finds Nykthos and has a ton of devotion.
Yep. There's Master of the Unseen. You do have to wonder how familiar these players are with the mirror, too.
Hopefully not that familiar, for their sakes.
Might be learning on the fly. Baumeister will draw. Yeah, manifest creatures are a mystery right now. Neither player with Courser in play. There's a Pelucranos, maybe. Looks like Corey's a little unsure if he wants to cast it at this point. Pelucranos actually seems like he'd be pretty good on this particular board, as it can maybe go after all those Elvish Mystics and force Cecchetti's hand on sacrificing his Wispwood Elemental.
Yeah, or losing a bunch of mana and then being at risk of Corey ever finding Nykthos or some other big payoff card.
Corey will manifest as well. Cecchetti going to very quickly sacrifice a Windswept Heath. He'll search for a Plains. We'll have a Mastery of the Unseen activation here, I believe, in just a moment. So it is time for one of those, another manifest creature. Cecchetti will draw a copy of Temple of Plenty to go along with the Teemer Sabertooth and the other copy of Mastery of the Unseen. And don't expect to see Teemer Sabertooth deployed for a long time.
Yeah, there's nothing going on right now, and there's nowhere near enough mana also.
There's a temple. Cecchetti deciding where he wants to put this card. Move to the bottom.
Whisperwood Elemental forces his hands a little bit on any sort of scry. Any creature stays on top, any non-creature probably just goes to the bottom.
It looks like he's going to deploy the Sabertooth right now. So he'll trigger here another manifest creature, and he does have the necessary mana to activate the Tamer's Sabertooth if necessary.
Tamer's Sabertooth does do a bit here to muck up Pelucranos.
More manifesting. Players just building up boards. Now this is interesting.
Ooh. I think he gets a reset here.
Yep.
So you can pick up your Nykthos.
Oh boy.
Fancy.
That's fancy. Somebody knows how their deck works.
Now that is a combo deck.
Look at you. You pepped up a little bit here.
Well, that was the first sweep play of the game. All right, I am invested now. There we go.
You think those are attacking?
Probably not.
No.
It's a pretty aggressive attack.
Maybe aiming back on D. Well, it's basically free when there's a Teemer Sabertooth.
I think Corey might throw out some speculative blocks, see how the waters taste. You know, see how the water feels.
There's Nykthos. That's going to come in.
Oh, yeah. Now we're getting somewhere.
Patrick's got a little.
Oh, yeah.
He's got a little pep in his step now.
Here we go.
Pelucranos on top.
Someone's going to perhaps have some permanents destroyed. Yeah. Pretty excited.
Might be time to manifest here with the Whisperwood. We'll see. Cecchetti with another copy of Master of the Unseen. And Nykthos in hand, two very important cards.
Sabertooth Manifest is sweet.
It is a nice little interaction.
That's
it?
A huge deal.
Yeah.
You know, the getting the Nykthos back and now another Nykthos, and he gets to keep it in hand because he was able to find one off the top of Courser. But
yeah. No, Sabertooth's like a mirror breaker, I think. I don't know if it is the mirror breaker. I mean, it's the mirror breaker right now for like this match in the finals of this Grand Prix. But
it's a pretty low cost mirror breaker because it's going to have a bunch of random spots where it's sweet.
There's a forest. Corey has a mastery of his own now. And he's ready to trigger his Whisper Woods. You mentioned the grid when we were watching Sam play. Corey's right. Doing a nice job of establishing
it. Yeah, we're entering the phase of the game where the real strategy comes with how your permanents are oriented and how to maximize the percentage of the board that your permanents are on.
Yeah.
This is a complicated game. And if you're going to play the green-white devotion deck at your local store, you're anticipating the mirror match, you have to develop this skill because you will run out of space.
Cecchetti now is going to unmorph Sylvan Carry added, which means he's going to be gaining some life.
And if you absorb enough of the board such that you start pushing your opponent's lands off the table, well, then you can stop worrying about a lot of different things.
That's true.
Nykthos, that's off the table. Don't have to worry about Blueknos anymore. Genesis Hydra loses a lot of power.
See if Cecchetti wants to unmorph anything else here. Looks like he has some interest in maybe unmorphing Blueknos. Yes. More life to be gained.
Don't worry about that. Don't worry so much about life totals. When we finally get to the spot where someone is attacking, it's going to be for so much damage that whatever life gains occurred is arbitrary almost.
Yep. Cecchetti will manifest here as well. And now he will sacrifice his Windswept Teeth. He'll stay at the same life total, thanks to Courser being in play. And he's got a healthy smile on his face. He's enjoying himself.
I'd be too.
And finals of a Grand Prix, man.
Finals of Grand Prix, great accomplishment. It seems you're in an advantaged position right now.
Teamer Sabretooth in play.
Yeah, just pure gas, firing on all cylinders.
Top card Voyaging Satyr.
It's like a car firing on all cylinders if the car could only drive in reverse.
Gonna unmorph Sylvan Caryatid. More life to be gained.
And Corey can't make a move right now with his own Blueknos because of the Teamer Sabretooth. It just mucks up.
Yeah, it doesn't do anything.
Yeah, he can make a move on, some manifest tokens and the Whisperwood Elemental or whatever. Yeah. But Daniel can just say, okay, you get the manifest tokens, that's fine. Whisperwood back to hand, and your Blueknos is done for.
Yep.
So I believe that it's only a matter of time, especially because Daniel is the one with Nykthos in play.
And a Nykthos in hand.
Right. And Teamer Sabretooth to just keep looping. I mean, it's going to take a while. Preface all this with it's going to take a while, but Daniel is starting to leverage a significant advantage in resources.
So two more manifests there for Baumeister, and now Cicchetti's going to untap, and now we get to go to his turn, because all of that took place at the end of Corey's turn. So he'll untap all these permanents. The draw for the turn will be Voyaging Satyr. Genesis Hydra on top. Now, of course, Genesis Hydra can be for a huge amount in this deck and in this position, especially when there's another Nykthos in Cicchetti's hand. But again, he's already got the Sabretooth, which is the card he'd want to find. He already has a Blueknos.
Yep. I mean, it's possible that he wants the Genesis Hydra because that gives him access to the one main deck Banishing Light. He has enough mana at this point where he can just flip over his whole deck. So the Genesis Hydra is significant for that reason. Also, remember, you don't have to worry about it getting manifested by the Whisperwood Elemental here because you can just pick it back up with the Sabretooth.
Another Nykthos here.
And this means that Daniel's making his move.
Yep. He's confident enough to do something here if he's cashing in a Nykthos. $26 mana floating. average amount.
Yep.
I think Pellegrino's probably going to get a little angry here.
Now, in order for Cecchetti to get through this, he has to start by going after, like, all the manifest creatures or a Wishboard Elemental, yes?
Right. So the problem here, what makes the Pellegrino's complicated outside of the 27 permanents he could potentially target, is the fact that if he goes after Whisperwood Elemental and a bunch of non-manifest creatures, or even just a bunch of non-manifest creatures in general, the Whisperwood Elemental can be sacrificed and there can be a re-up, just a bunch of manifest tokens come down. So the first order of business is take care of the Whisperwood Elementals. You can also take care of face-down manifest creatures along the way, because those don't get replaced if you sacrifice Whisperwood Elemental. So the first order of business for Daniel is to slog through the Whisperwood Elementals. Then after that, he can pick apart whatever he wants to pick apart.
Yep. Now it looks like he's saying, I want to go after Pellegrino's. I want to go after Pellegrino's, Whisperwood Elemental, Voyaging Satyr.
Now, going after Pellegrino's makes sense if you are worried about what happens if Corey draws a Nykthos and fires back at you.
Sure.
I don't think ultimately Daniel has to worry too much about that because the Sabertooth gives him a lot of insurance, but Pellegrino's definitely the most dangerous card in play right now, besides the Whisperwood Elementals, and possibly more dangerous from Daniel's perspective than even the Whisperwood Elementals.
I like the idea of trying to take down Voyaging Satyr here too, because then the Voyaging Satyr in combination with maybe a peeled Nykthos.
Right, what's Corey's way to get out of this jam? It involves Nykthos, and in the event that he draws Nykthos, you want to pin down as much devotion as you possibly can, the big payouts like Pellegrino's, and cards like Voyaging Satyr that allow you to untap.
We're going to find out how familiar Corey is with the mirror match. I feel like Cecchetti is fairly right. Familiar.
Yeah. And Corey probably still has a couple more turns for some draw sets to make the game competitive, but it is definitely slipping away. He's going to be losing his premier permanents very soon. And at that point, there's really no catching up, especially since Daniel can just return Pellegrino's to his hand and do this over and over again.
Yep. So those creatures will die, and there will be two manifests because Whisperwood Elemental got sacrificed, but some work was done.
Right. Again, you know, as long as Daniel's under no immediate risk of Corey having some sort of, you know, commiserate response to what's going on here, Daniel can take his time. And if his entire turn is generate 7,000 mana and kill only Whisperwood Elemental, that's fine because he can just go back and do this the following turn.
Corey's going to keep taking a look at the manifest creatures here. See what he's got down there. We won't know. He'll also manifest.
Mysteries abound.
Indeed. Cecchetti's going to manifest his Genesis Hydra. That one will be face up along with the manifest pile there. And now Pellegrino's on top of the deck. And so what we'll see probably over the course of a couple of turns here is Cecchetti just going, okay, end of turn, return my Pellegrino's with Teamer Sabertooth, redeploy, reset up, nuke you again.
Right. We've also reached the point where Daniel's, I would argue, his Whisperwood Elementals and possibly his Elvish Mystics have passed the 50th percentile line of the playmat. He is now formally encroaching on Corey's side of the table. I don't mind this play because he's in a commanding position.
No flag has been thrown.
There's no flag thrown yet, but it's possible Corey will take this personally.
Sneaky with the Elvish Mystic, though. You can barely notice that it's encroaching.
Yeah. You got to start small. You can't just shove all your opponent's permanents off the table to start with. It's a slow build-up.
Adrian Sullivan watching at home, good friend with Daniel Cecchetti. Some people, I think, wishing at home that maybe all the permanents that Daniel was playing were turned towards Corey as an homage to Adrian.
Right. Shades of the grid. Shades of the Cali box out.
Indeed.
Shades of Adrian Sullivan. Indeed. There's a lot of influences going on this table right now.
So Pellegrino's has been returned, as we expected it would be. And there may be some unmorphing that does take place here.
Yep. So Reed Duke once made a comment. I watched him play a Miracles, pretty awesome game with Miracles once in Legacy, where he was frustrated with himself that he made some small operations errors. And he said, you know, with this deck, there's so many things going on. It's so complicated. You just try to do the best you can. If you play 95% Magic, that's good enough. I think this mirror match, we're closer to, I don't know, it's like baseball batting average. Like, if you're hitting 30% once you get to this stage, you're doing pretty good.
You're doing pretty well for yourself.
Because there's just so many permutations of these turns. As long as Daniel doesn't do anything too crazy besides, you know, kill your most important stuff as I can, make sure the Tamer Sabertooth keeps my Pelucranos or Whisperwood Elementals protected, it's going to be close enough even if he isn't, you know, maximum efficiency with all of his mana and all of his resources every turn.
Can never let the Sabertooth die.
Yes.
That's pretty much the trick. You know, if I were playing, maybe I'd set two mana next to it and say, okay, this is making sure that I don't goof and do something dumb. Because as long as the Sabertooth never dies, he's just fine. He's going to add a bunch of green mana right now through Nykthos. We might see him Genesis Hydra here for a lot to maybe try to find the Banishing Light to take care of the Whisperwood Elemental, or he might just go back to Pelucranos Rod again.
Right, or both even.
Yeah.
The Genesis Hydra is effectively for his entire deck, so at a moment's notice he can get the Banishing Light. I actually would not go and get the Banishing Light right now because the Banishing Light is Daniel's only answer to Banishing Light. And the way that Corey gets out from under this potentially is drawing the Banishing Light, getting rid of the Tamer Sabertooth, and then trying to rebuild from there.
Sure.
So I would just want to have the Banishing Light already set aside to answer a potential Banishing Light off the top of Corey's deck.
8 green seems to be floating here. So here's the Hydra. 6 for the Hydra. I have to imagine Voyaging Seder will be the selection, as that's just another copy of Nykthos in this situation. So Cecchetti will get to shuffle his deck. We'll get to see the top card here in just a moment, thanks to the Courser that's in play.
See, I'm staying with it. I only had to watch this matchup once to sort of get an idea for what the strategy was.
Absolutely.
The first time, you're wandering around in the dark. Really hard to make heads or tails or anything because there's 1,000 permanents in play, unlimited mana. But now, one game, well, I wouldn't call it one game because the game didn't finish. But
sure.
Watching the mirror in action for an hour, now I'm pretty looped into what's going on here.
It's all based around, at least in game one, the Sabertooth.
Yeah.
There's another copy of Master of the Unseen. Wishwood Elemental triggers. As Corey will take a look, Cecchetti puts his Wishwood Elemental trigger on the stack. And Corey's going to take a look at all of his manifest creatures to make sure he knows what they are. Again, his have to remain face down because he doesn't have a Courser in play. So a little bit inconvenient as now Corey is beginning his encroachment.
Yep.
He'll gain quite a bit of life here. It's like 14.
The life gain, you know, to reiterate, is kind of this sure whatever sort of thing. Doesn't really matter all that much.
And now here's a Sylvan Curry added, so another 14 life will be gained. And I do agree, for the most part, the life gain is rather trivial.
Yeah, once Daniel's in a position to whittle enough away of Corey's board where he can start making some attacks, Corey could be at, you know, 500, 1,000. It probably doesn't matter all that much.
This will be hitting him for, you know, 100 each turn.
Right.
Corey will draw. He's still without a Nykthos here. He does have a Master of the Unseen. Let's make it 2. And a bit of a smile here as well. And he says, I'll trigger Whisperwood Elemental. And now Cecchetti's going to go reaching.
You know what the real tech is for the mirror match?
Ooh, what's that?
The second team or Sabretooth, because then Banishing Light doesn't get you out.
All right. I can see that.
That's how you step your game up.
You know what the real tech is?
Hmm?
Splash another color. Black, preferably. Yeah, it's probably like a Dune Blast. It's probably pretty good in the mirror, right?
I guess. I don't even know if it would be particularly good once you get to this state. It's probably fine, but a Wrath or even Wrath and leave one creature in play, you know, when both players have access to Mastery does not seem that great to me.
Arcbound of Depravity.
Okay.
That flyer that at the end of your opponent's turn, they have to sacrifice all their creatures but two.
What about that, what about the Moto Misclick one?
That's that one.
Okay, that's the one?
Yeah,
all right,
that's the magic on that misclick one.
Good in the mirror match, and definitely good in the magic online version of the mirror match.
Bang. 19 green floating.
Looks like both players temporarily respecting each other's territorial sovereignty. No encroachment. Pulled back a little bit.
Nice of them. Looks like this will be an attempt at a Pelucranos activation. Whisperwood and some mana accelerants. You can tell Cecchetti knows what's going on in the mirror. Just the way that he's positioning everything and when he's making his moves and the mana that he's got left over, you can definitely tell.
Yeah.
I'm going to go after this Whisperwood, those mana accelerants. Stunt your mana a little bit. Move forward accordingly.
Yeah, it's sort of this order of operation things where the first thing to go has to be the most critical permanent. Whisperwood Elemental, Pelucranos, those are the most threatening things. Once you get past that, the next thing is mana, because mana is a thing that conceivably allows your opponent to fire back at you. After that, you just mop up whatever the leftovers are. They don't really matter very much.
And this loop will allow Cecchetti to do that. Now Corey's going to float two green. He'll sacrifice his Whisperwood Elemental. Pelucranos is going to resolve now, which means that Corey will manifest twice. As both Elvis Mystics did die. We might have a Mastery of the Unseen activation here, but as you mentioned, life totals and the amount of life that Corey can gain, while it's a lot, don't get me wrong, it becomes trivial at some point because eventually Corey's entire board gets destroyed by Pelucranos.
Daniel is in the process, slowly but surely, of locking Corey up.
Yep.
So it is going to take a while, and a lot of Corey's manifests here are going to find, say, a Whisperwood Elemental or a Pelucranos that requires another response. So again, it's a slow burn, but I believe it's only a matter of time.
Looks like a Corsair's going to get on more. Of course, he's going to gain a bunch of life here. Of course, it will double. So however many creatures that are in play, multiply that times two because there's two copies of Master of the Unseen in play. So up to 86. And it might be more than that in just a moment.
So I was really hoping, just on a selfish level, that this would be one of those uncheck Whisperwood Elemental Pelucranos type games. That said, the next best option, I think, is to have a game like this where the difference in the deck is really being demonstrated. Teamer Saber 2, this is the whole thing. This is the whole thing.
Yep.
It's one slot in the deck.
But for this tournament, it's the Mirror Breaker.
Yep.
And we've seen players try to actually put this card, because it's such a unique card for a green card.
Yeah, it's an oddball. I mean, we saw this in the Teamer Ascendancy combo deck a little bit earlier on.
Yep.
Very impressive in that deck.
It's only one slot here. Very impressive here. The fact that you can, when you start kind of going off of this deck and generating a bunch of mana and getting a bunch of life, inevitably you'll be able to find it, and then Pelucranos can just kill everything, and there's really nothing you can do about it. So now we're reaching. And redeploying Pelucranos, it looks like.
Again, this is just the slow but sure whittling down.
And Cecchetti has plenty of mana to be able to make this turn because he has a Nykthos in play, as you can see. And he's got two copies of Voyaging Satyr, so those are Nykthos's number 2 and 3.
Yeah.
So he's going to do the count here to see how much devotion he has, which is obviously quite a bit. Looks like 19 green. He says, all right, I'll just do this.
Yeah, there's no reason really for Daniel to main phase anything with the Pelucranos at this current point. He can just save all the stuff for the end of Corey's turn.
Yep. Looks like he's got on Morph here. He'll gain a boatload of life now because he has two copies of Master of the Unseen in play. Looks like he's got 16 mana floating. As I mentioned, Voyaging Satyr is going to act as Nykthos number 2, mm-hmm. and then Voyaging Satyr number 2 will act as Nykthos number 3. So mana will be added and subtracted just a little bit, but there will be a lot of mana here. And Daniel's going to try to see if he can add more mana than he has life, but only 54, just a touch short.
Almost.
Yeah.
Still, good run.
Not bad. See if we can find our 54-sided die. Looks like we don't have that one. So there's, we have to get out the 20-sider.
Right.
It's 26. I imagine 4 to that and 2 to... Yeah, we can go a couple different routes here. 4 to that, 3 to each Fleece Mane Lions.
It's good to get the Fleece Mane Lions off the table because those eventually become annoying blockers.
Yeah, that's the best way to describe them, is annoying.
And Daniel does only have so many enormous creatures to attack with. If he starts Alva Striking and there's some monstrous Fleece Mane Lions on defense, then, you know, maybe some of the coursers start getting whittled down. And Corey has a lot of luxury to take some lumps here because he's going to be at, you know, 257,000 life by the time Daniel's able to cobble together some attacks. So... the Fleece Mane Lions are nice to get off the table when you have an opportunity to do so.
Yeah, I think he's going to take that opportunity. Genesis Hydra is going to be turned face up. It's going to die, but Corey will gain a bunch of life. Again, however many creatures in play, you can multiply times 2 because of Master of the Unseen.
Yeah, Corey just trying to get a little bit on the way out. But, again, not something with a lot of strategic implication to the game.
We have a high five here. See, everybody's having a good time.
Yeah, they are having a blast.
Our decks are broken.
Had the best deck for the tournament. No one can argue that.
It's not even close to arguable. Some players have had some great runs this weekend, Chad Castell, Andrew Boswell, but it's not even arguable. Here are all the creatures that are being turned over. Is this? I thought it was a concession.
All right, Corey going to play on here.
Yep.
Still a lot of magic to be played.
I can respect that. Finals of a Grand Prix, I'm not going anywhere. Take a draw step. Yes.
Oh, and some encroachment to boot.
That is how you play. That is how it is done right
there. Wow.
It's on his terms. He's not going anywhere. And if I was Cecchetti?
No blocks.
No blocks.
No blocks.
Nope. Because that could be anything.
Right.
He will block. Forrest.
Hey, you want to know something?
Yeah.
We were kidding around. Game one, 35 minutes. For the finals of the Grand Prix,
yep.
That is not an unreasonable length for
That's
the first
easy.
Game.
That's easy breezy.
Now, around the 27, 28-minute mark, I wanted to say, call me a foolish optimist, but I felt like game one was going to be over and under an hour. But I couldn't risk the 80th minute rolling around, and then it's still going on. But 35 minutes is really not that bad in the scheme of things for the finals of the Grand Prix.
Daniel Cecchetti does win game number one here over Corey Baumeister in the green-white devotion mirrors. We take a look at the sideboards. We will start with Corey and his two Nissa World Wakers, his three Boon Satyrs, his two Reclamation Sages, two Glare of Heresy, four Valor Stance, and then two copies of High Sentinels of Arishin.
So I like the Valor Stances a lot and the Reclamation Sages as well, and the High Sentinels. I think that's a pretty solid package. Some removal, some interaction, Glare of Heresy as well, and High Sentinels is something to go crazy with that can actually get around a lot of the defensive stuff going on in the other deck.
On the other side, we've got two Fleece Main Lines, two Hornet Nest, a Hornet Queen, two Reclamation Sage, and a Last Breath, along with the Setessan Tactics, a Valor Stance, two Nissa World Waker, a Glare of Heresy, and two Hunt the Hunter.
Much the same story. I like Hunt the Hunter, Glare of Heresy, Last Breath, especially Setessan Tactics, Valor Stance. The removal spells in the matchup, I think, are very positive here. Reclamation Sage as well, just way to blow up the enchantment. So it's going to be a lot of the same sideboarding. I think Daniel kind of gets the better end of it because Setessan Tactics is awesome.
Yep.
And he's got, I think, slightly more efficient removal as well.
I think that I didn't really see this coming. You know, when I found out some players are going to play in Green Knight Devotion, you know, we ran into Chris Van Meter, Brian Bronduin, Brad.
They all
brother.
Said the deck was insane.
Yeah.
All of them were on board with yep. this, by the way.
But at no point had they really said, well, we're going to prepare for the mirror. Mm-hmm. Because that wasn't really on the radar. They just felt like, hey, we have an awesome deck for the tournament. We don't think anyone knows that we have an awesome deck for the tournament. So this is what we're going to do. And we know about it. The chances of anyone else knowing about it, pretty slim. Mm-hmm. But if you know Sam Black, you can't get anything by Sam Black when it comes to Constructed, because
no.
he's always brewing.
I mean, he has such a resume as a deck builder. The Aristocrats, obviously, probably his defining signature deck.
I would say so.
You know, we covered a bunch of Legacy tournaments several years ago where he was on this Gravecrawler Goblin Bombardment Cartel Aristocrat kick.
Yep.
He goes really deep in the card pool. Yeah. And not only had the deck as well, but had the Breaker for the Mirror and Teamer Sabertooth.
And that's the thing that's really, really compelling to me is, you know, Brad, obviously, best standard player in the world. I don't even think it's arguable at this point. And he found this deck and worked on it, and they have a beautiful list of the deck. His brother's in the finals of the Grand Prix. Sam independently kind of comes up with the deck with the Madison crew, and Sam identifies that this deck is insane, and we need a way to break the mirror in case anyone else has realized the deck is insane, and they have the proper tools to break the mirror.
Yeah.
That part to me, because when you're building a deck and you think you've cracked it, you think of Dark Depths. You think of Dredge. Everyone's just like, okay, well, just don't talk about it. No one knows about it. I'm sure when you were playing in the Pro Tour, I think, like, Oath maybe got unleashed on a tournament, or Tinker, what have you.
Yeah, I mean, Illusions, Necro Donate, the first tournament that was available. I mean, there were some definite decks where the Nether Hops deck in Standard, the Jogal Hops Nether Spirit deck, yep. which was so far ahead of its curve. There were some tournaments where we had the first Icarit deck. We had the first Icarit deck. Well, we would have had the first Icarit deck if Osip didn't play it in a trial for no reason. I'm just saying, I've been involved in some tournaments where
sure.
something insane got busted out for the first time.
Yeah, and never does anyone have, like, the same conversation is had among the group of people working on it, which is, well, no one, we don't have to prep for the mirror, no one has it. If we run into each other, that happens, who cares? But these guys have stuff in the mirror.
But it's not even just the mirror match, right? Well, so Teamer Sabertooth is two green for devotion, and obviously interacts very nicely with Manifest, which is something I didn't even see until I saw it for the first time
yep.
right there. But you can pick up cards like your Banishing Lights and Mastery Tendencies and make those, like, get set down. And you know, obviously in the mirror match where nothing's going on and it's just about who can bring the biggest trump to the table, Teamer Sabertooth is really going to shine in those kind of games. But I'm sure it's fine in a bunch of spots that we saw kind of in the mid game where it's like, yeah, I have some mana to work with and I have some cool stuff going on here. And Teamer Sabertooth is a functional card, even outside the mirror match.
Yeah. And so, of course, we take a look at the sideboards. We Hunt the Hunter, a card that we never really see in sideboards.
Right.
And Setessan Tactics, I mean, from a previous standard format, of course, it's a way for green-white decks and green decks to beat mono-blue devotion, so they had a way to kill Master of the Waves, but we haven't seen it for a little while, and these are cards that can be mirror breakers as we play the second and potentially a third game here in the finals of this Grand Prix.
Yeah, no, it all matters, and this deck is so far ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
As you mentioned, it's one thing to have the deck, and then it's another thing to have the deck that also has the plan to beat the mirror match in the event that someone else has it.
And one last thing, as Corey will be coming back and we'll be underway for game number two in just a moment, you know, when you were coming up, because obviously you were a little bit before me, and when I was coming up, you know, the sharing of information was something that people did such a good job of keeping secret because the internet was in its infant stages. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, if someone has a deck that's going to take a turn by storm, everyone knows about it in some capacity. Rarely will you see someone where, oh, I had no idea that was a thing. You know, I've played in tournaments where that has happened. The first time that Dredge won a tournament, Mike Crum won Grand Prix Charlotte with that deck many, many moons ago in the mid-2000s, where, you know, I'm hearing stories and, you know, Jerry T is playing the deck, Crum is playing the deck, Billy Bosswaite's playing the deck. I'm sure some of the guys, you know, I don't know if Osip was playing the deck then or not, but, you know, the stories on the floor, you know, my opponent had no idea what I was doing, and I killed him on turn three, games one and two. Rarely do you see that in Magic nowadays.
Yeah, Pro Tour Houston, there was some sort of Hermit Druid deck that we didn't have, obviously.
Yeah.
And just saw, I was sitting next to it one round, watched it in action, and then walked over to my team afterwards, and I'm like, we suck.
Yeah.
There's no way we can win this tournament.
We don't have the deck for this tournament. Right.
Wasn't even the deck.
Yeah.
I mean, arguably, Oath of Druids was, Reanimator was, The Rock was, whatever. Just, yep. You can watch certain decks in action and know that what you have is not commiserate to what they have.
Yeah. You saw it at Pro Tour Theros with Mono Blue Devotion, where some players were just like, yeah, I'm playing green-white. Obviously, green-white's great. And, you know, the Pantheon's just like, we have Mono Blue Devotion. We have Thassa and Master Flaves. And what are you guys
Tide
even
Binder
doing?
Mage.
Yeah, main deck Tidefinder Mage. Right. You're up. And, you know, again, rarely do you ever see that happen nowadays. And it's actually kind of taking place right now. So we have two green-white Devotion decks in the finals of this Grand Prix from two different teams who identified it, that it is fantastic. They were both right, obviously. And one of these teams has a mirror match breaker in Team or Saber.
The base of this deck, there was an open a few weeks ago, where the finalist was playing Naya.
Yep.
And it wasn't a Nykthos Naya deck, I don't believe. Yep. It was more just, I have a bunch of land drops, I have Xenagos, I generate a bunch of tokens. And there were games there where Mastery of the Unseen was incredible.
Yeah.
And that sort of got the wheels turning in my head that maybe there's something more here than just an anti-control card, which is what I pigeonholed it when I saw it the first time. And obviously, it's far past that at this point. I mean, the card in this deck provides so much, again, the stabilizing influence early on in the game, and then later on, a way to just go bananas with Nykthos. It's a way to gain life, so cards like Ashcloud, Phoenix, and Stormbreath Dragon don't punk you out. Those cards have typically been a problem for Devotion decks in the past, so it's just a very impressive addition to this deck, and now we have a mirror match in the finals.
Yeah, it's rare that you see it, but we'll see who's able to get the job done. Daniel Cecchetti is currently up a game right now after an impressive performance of Team Red Sabertooth, Pelucranos, that kind of loop going on, and Corey Baumeister is going to try to even things up here. Again, his sideboard, two Nissa World Wakers, three Boon Satyrs, two Reclamation Sage, two Glare of Heresy, four Valorous Dance, two copies of High Sentinels of Erishin. He does have cards to bring to the table, thankfully for him. I'm not sure they're as good as Cecchetti's are, but at least he has something to bring to the table.
No, I don't think they are as good. High Sentinels is something that gets caught up by some removal and really is only powerful in spots where Corey has a lot of mana, something that can get overpowered and killed. I think that I would rather have the removal that Daniel is bringing to the table, particularly as a test in tactics, but I think High Sentinels is capable of doing some real damage here.
Yeah. And of course, Cecchetti, you see the two Fleece Mane Alliance, a two Hornet Nest, a Hornet Queen, two Reclamation Sage, a Last Breath, Sedescent Tactics, a Valorous Stance, two Nissa World Wakers, a Glare of Heresy, and two Hunt the Hunters. Hunt the Hunter looks nice, Sedescent Tactics looks nice, some nice options here available. But we're not surprised to see Cecchetti win game number one, mm-hmm. just because we felt that that's the way the game can go, and then Tiber Sabertooth will eventually be found and take the game down. And I would be surprised if he loses the next two games.
Well, the other thing about it is nothing that Corey has in his sideboard addresses the problem of Teamer Sabertooth.
Yeah.
You know, Valorous Dance, no good. Glare of Heresy, no good. Reclamation Sage, no good. High Sentinels is possibly a way to overpower it, but it's not a direct answer.
So now it's likely that Corey has to try to play kind of a weirder game, which is maybe just to try to out-aggressive him.
Well, he's kind of the beat-down deck in the matchup because due to the presence of Teamer Sabertooth, and I believe to a lesser extent, Setessan Tactics, Daniel has inevitability. If both of us are just sitting there building up our boards and doing things with our mana, eventually Daniel will get some sort of enormous edge because he's got some real breakers in the event the game stalls out. High Sentinels can replicate that for Corey, but I think it's a little bit slower than Setessan Tactics and a little bit less reliable than Teamer Sabertooth and the various things you can combo with.
Well, game number two will be underway here. If you are just joining us, we appreciate having you. Cedric Phillips, Patrick Sullivan, of course, Nick Miller in the sideboard, along with the rest of the SCG Live crew. Our final round here at Grand Prix Miami, and what has been one heck of a tournament. Around 1,400 players came out to do battle. A great top eight, a lot of fun matches to watch. We've watched Pro Tour champions, both new and old. Grand Prix champions, the same. Platinum, gold, silver level pros. We've got to watch some great magic, a lot of different decks in what is a very, very healthy standard format. Got to preview four exclusive cards for Dragon's Tarkir. And now we watch Green White Devotion in the finals of this tournament. It's going to win it. We're just going to figure out who it's going to be.
Talked a lot about Corey Baumeister, obviously being a sibling of Brad Nelson. Daniel Cecchetti has a bit of a magic resume himself, a former United States World Cup team member.
Absolutely. Oh, he can play some magic.
Yep.
No doubt about that. That was never in question, and he is in a good chance, he's a good spot, excuse me, to win this Grand Prix.
He's got to be happy with the matchup. I mean, when your deck is this far ahead of the curve, you'd probably prefer not to play the mirror match, but he does have quite a bit more action for it.
Well, both players will finish shuffling up, and don't forget, next weekend, there is a Grand Prix taking place in Cleveland, Ohio. First time since 2002.
Mm-hmm.
It'll be Kaza Tarkir, Fate Reforged Limited. And there will also be an Open Series event taking place in Dallas, Texas.
You'll be in the house for Cleveland.
I will be in the house. We're going to go see Mama and Papa Bear.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe I'll run into LeBron James. Who knows?
It's unlikely.
If you have that attitude, you're right. I'm just going to drive around. I know where he lives.
Yeah.
So.
Unless LeBron happens to be hanging out at the $25 blackjack tables or the Spaghetti Factory. But hey, best of luck.
Hey, thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that.
No worries.
I think we'd enjoy breaking bread at the Spaghetti Factory.
Yeah, sure.
It'd be a lot of fun, at least for one of us. Hey, who doesn't like spaghetti?
It's true.
Are you kidding me? Delicious and nutritious. And both players shuffled up here. They will shuffle each other's decks, and we will underway here for game number two. Seems as though Cecchetti is the favorite here. Another member of the Madison crew, which is a crew that's been good for a long time, but I think right now really starting to establish itself.
It's a storied history.
It really is.
They go way back. At any era you look at it, Magic's competitive history, there's been some crew. Some people have stuck through pretty much the entire time. You know, Adrian Sullivan comes to mind. Bob Barr comes to mind. But
Brian Kowal. Sam Black. Justin Cohen making a name for himself at the last Pro Tour, even though he's been around for a long time. Cecchetti here.
There's just a wave of just really good gamers, and it's one of those things where when you have a community like that, when you are able to identify someone with some talent, you immediately get them into the lab.
Yeah.
They get to be incubated around real talent. And so success has a habit of getting more success from different people in your group.
Corey taking a mulligan pretty quickly here. Looks like Cecchetti's okay with his opening hand. You know, a name that most people probably watching this that don't know, Mike Horan.
Yep.
Might forget about him. He was
former Pro Tour champion.
Yeah, he's part of that group too. PTQs were real tough up there back in the day.
I believe it. It's a university town, which you usually associate with some quality magic players. Once you have a local community, you just breed more talent.
I actually never played a PTQ there during my college days either, which is pretty strange because I went to Purdue an hour away from Indy and played in, I can't even count how many Chicago PTQs, and never made it up to the Wisconsin area for PTQs.
Wisconsin, University of Wisconsin was actually on my short list of colleges to go to.
Yeah, fair enough. You're going to be a Badger.
I thought about it, yeah. Ended up being a pirate, briefly.
Arr. Here is a forest and a passing of the turnover, Cecchetti. Cecchetti with a forest and he'll pass. As game number two is underway here of the Green-White Devotion Mirror. Nykthos into Caryatid.
And that's a tool that Corey did not have last game.
Yep.
Now, these decks are slightly better at interacting in the post-board games. There are some removal spells, so Man acceleration in Nykthos is not guaranteed to be a runaway like it is in game one, but it's still one of the most important cards.
Cecchetti does have an accelerant. He has the better one of the two there in Voyaging Satyr. Temple of Plenty here for Corey. Card looks like it's going to stay on top. Myers and carry added and pass the turn back, so some healthy mana acceleration.
Right, this is the turn three Whisperwood Elemental kind of opening.
Looks to be Courser time. Cecchetti will take a look at the top card. It's a Courser. Does he have a land to play? He does have a forest in hand, so he will play that. I'll pass the turn back.
So Cecchetti has brought in Nissa. And cracking out some 4/4s does not seem like what this matchup is about.
Maybe untapping some lands might be okay.
Or going ultimate.
Touche. Hadn't really considered that. Here's Pelucros. Pass the turn back. First real threat being presented now. Yeah. Course of the draw. Take a look at the top card here for Cecchetti. It's a Genesis Hydra.
I do not think that Cecchetti has a land, and that is really bad news.
Yep.
Because there's no land coming, and I'd be surprised if that Voyaging Satyr got to go into Daniel's next turn.
And his hand's not great either. You see, he's got a Genesis Hydra, a Courser. Redundant Courser, certainly not good right now. Nissa, two copies of Master of the Unseen, and a Whisperwood Elemental. Looks like it's going to be Master of the Unseen. And another one. And pass the turn back.
And that card's really potent once you have a bunch of mana, but until then, it's not worth very much. And if Daniel's getting pinned on mana here, those cards will offer very, very little. The most obvious play right now is just to go at Voyaging Satyr and start attacking.
It's the clear-cut one.
Right.
I'm not sure it's the one he wants to make, but it's a clear-cut one.
Right. Still worth seeing if there's another line available.
Because by, going that route, obviously it's a Stone Rain, or basically one, and you have a large creature that can close the game out quickly. And the longer the game goes, the more it favors Cecchetti, given the inevitability that he showed in the last game.
Yeah, he's really far away from cobbling together anything that really matters, so Corey may elect to play kind of a longer game here. He's not in rush of anything too bad happening, but still, the sooner the better.
And he's going to go with taking care of Voyaging Satyr, it looks like. So Pelucros will do that and get in here for 7 points of damage. 3-turn clock.
Yep.
Well, I'm sure pass the turn back over to Cecchetti. Cecchetti will draw Genesis Hydra. This needs to be a land for it to be a game. It's an Elvish Mystic. Well, Genesis Hydra
for
can
one.
Find that. Yep.
Boom. And you get another shot at a land.
Yeah.
What's not to like?
Well, fair enough. There are worse places to be. Those turnover and shortcut here. Maybe it'll be a four shuffle. We'll see. I felt like he was shortcutting there by just saying, I'm just going to Genesis Hydra for one. The top card of my deck is Elvish Mystic, so there's no reason for me to shuffle, which is interesting. I think they're also going to see that if I Genesis Hydra, am I supposed to reveal the card, which I don't think you're supposed to.
Then shuffle the rest into your library is not a totally clear template in the event that you're Genesis Hydra for one. To me, it implies there needs to be something to shuffle in for you to shuffle.
Yeah. I know what Cecchetti was trying to do there. It seems kind of clear to me if you've ever played with someone who's trying to just shortcut given the situation. Though, you know, we'll see what the judge is ruling here.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know exactly how this works. The template is not clear in instances where the Genesis Hydra is for one.
Yeah. So I think Daniel's plan.
It has to be for one, and it has to hit for one.
Yeah.
Because otherwise there's a card that you shovel back in.
I think Daniel's, what he was implying was basically, I'm doing this for one. My deck is random because I haven't played any temples or anything. So this is my one card. I guess they're just going to cause him to shuffle. So fair enough. You can see he's even taken back by it a little bit.
That would not be my intuition for how it works, but it also doesn't really matter.
Yep.
So whatever.
Until he peels a land off the top now.
Well, a different random card matters, but, you know, from a rules perspective. And Nykthos.
Yeah, Temple.
Oh, even better.
Yeah, Temple, obviously. Yeah.
Naturally.
Yeah. Mr. Perfect. And Nykthos.
Yeah, okay. Yep.
Well, for what it's worth, that's how it was supposed to be resolved anyway.
Yeah.
Right?
I guess.
Because Genesis Hydra, you do one, and then you shuffle the deck, I suppose, afterwards. So
I trust the judge's ruling. Like I said, the template is not super clear in that instance, but
that's why they're there.
Right.
We just watch the games unfold.
I'm certainly not appealing. So yep. If Corey's fine, I'm fine.
Here is an attack with a large Pelucranos. Cecchetti says, I will take it. He's down to 8 now. Mastery of the Unseen. There's a Windswept Teeth.
But Daniel is pulling right back into this. He's going to start working with a lot of mana. Corey doesn't really have a lot going on, except he's going to be cranking out a 2-2 every turn.
Which isn't terrible.
Yeah, that's not bad, but that's something that Daniel can manage, I think. He has to chump block the Pelucranos every turn, or eventually kill it, or gain life to push out in front, but he seems like he's capable of doing a mixture of those things, given the resources that he has.
Yep. Perhaps it's time for Nissa. This could be a really good turn.
And given that Corey is not cheating just yet, he's not doing a million insano busted things.
Yep.
Nissa's ultimate could be a game plan here.
This turn's really good, because now he gets to add devotion, too. So now
yeah, this is
2, 4, 6, 7 green.
Is not just right back in it, but actually quite ahead now.
I was going to say, might be winning now. 2 mana floating. It's colorless. Excuse me, it's green. My apologies. Caryatid's going to come in. Oh, we'll see a response here from Corey. Looks like he's just going to sacrifice the Windswept Teeth. Get a land out of his deck. And Cecchetti's actually maybe expecting his Wishwood Elemental to die.
Nope. Just looks
like a manifest to me. I take it back.
Oh, so it's Valorous Dance plus an activation.
Okay.
Here.
There's a card. So no manifest here for Cecchetti. He's at 9. Getting to the point where it might be time to start blocking that Pelucranos.
Well, I think that he can take probably one more hit here because he's not at risk of getting burned out. And he doesn't really want to chump block with either of his creatures this turn because Daniel's really leaning on devotion and doing things with Nykthos to be able to crawl back into the game. So I think that ideally he would like to take a blow here, try to develop his board, and in the process of developing his board, come up with one chump blocker to handle Pelucranos, or perhaps draw something soon that just allows him to take care of it outright.
But you mentioned that there is no burn in the green-white devotion deck, and I clearly agree with you. I don't know if we want to classify Boonsader as a burn spell.
I would be stunned if that was in Corey's deck.
Yeah.
This matchup is all about just doing the biggest, baddest thing. And Boonsader is probably for control matchups where you need to get away from the devotion engine a little bit.
Here comes Pelucranos again. And it looks like it's going towards Nyssa. And Genesis Hydra's going to block, which is important there for Corey because it does lower the devotion a little bit.
Right. So I think that if Corey goes and attacks Daniel there, Daniel probably says no blocks.
Yep.
But Nyssa's more valuable than Genesis Hydra, yep. So he's going to keep it.
Cecchetti will untap. And let's just see how broken he can go. Carry added to the draw. Top card of the deck is a Pelucranos. Genesis Hydra in hand, along with that carry added and a Courser. He can make a pretty healthy amount of mana this turn. I'm just trying to figure out, just doing all the math to see just how crazy he can go.
If he can get to 10 mana, then that allows him to Genesis Hydra for 8. Now Pelucranos is no longer a concern, and he's going to get, at the minimum, a Pelucranos for his troubles.
Sure. He'll start with a Courser. 7 devotion to green here with Nykthos if he wants to activate it.
I suppose you could also just Genesis Hydra for 7 and with the intent on trading with Pelucranos, which is not quite as good as shutting it off, but still fine for Daniel's purposes.
Yep. Carry at it. Eight mana. This is for 6. Pelucranos is an option. He will go with Pelucranos, as that's the best of the bunch.
I imagine Daniel will actually shuffle his deck.
He will shuffle his deck,
since
yes.
There were 5 cards to shuffle back in.
Yes.
I'm starting to get the hang of it.
For the next time you step out of the booth and play a game of Magic.
Right.
That's important.
Because this is the deck I'm going to pick up. And I want to be really well versed on the mirror match.
I put you on this, that's for sure. Top card of the deck here is another copy of Pelucranos. So Cecchetti's starting to pull away a little bit here.
The engine is getting set up here. He's got some life to play with. It's becoming really hard for Corey to muster some attacks here.
Corey sliding into the red zone here, mm-hmm. Starting to take.
Yeah, encroachment taking effect here. Yep. We have crossed the 50th percentile. Daniel taking a more defensive posture with his board stays probably still north of 40%. But he's starting to get pushed back a little bit.
Corey can manifest again if he'd like. So maybe he has something to unmorph here. We'll see. I want to see if there's maybe a high Sentinels. Yep.
Okay. This is one of the big swing cards in the matchup for Corey here.
Yeah.
Since Daniel's deck not really good at blocking the air.
So there is high Sentinels. 3-4, actually a 4-5 right now. He gets +1/+1 for each other creature you control with a +1/+1 counter on it, which Pelucranos does have. And that means he can actually go after Nyssa in the air. So 4-5 right now, he can +1/+1 counter on another creature, and he can take care of Nyssa. Though the damage that Nyssa has done so far might be good enough.
Well, Corey has the option of trying to do something like make an attack this turn that takes care of Nyssa, try to set up an attack for next turn that takes care of you.
Yep. The problem with that is, at least from what I can tell, the 2 copies of Master of the Unseen.
Yes.
Because damage racing becomes impossible.
No, then. I'm saying trying to close out in this through this turn and next, not trying to go real long. I agree that that's a problem. Also, the fact that Pelucranos might just gun down your High Sentinels is an issue as well. But at the minimum, this is a window to take care of Nyssa.
I think you probably have to take that one to get this off the table. It's
close, though.
Given that Daniel has the capability of attack of gaining quite a bit of life potentially, it seems like attacking for short of lethal does not do very much. Either you're trying to keep his board in check by taking care of the Planeswalker, or you're trying to come across for lethal.
Corey going to weigh his options here. He's trying to figure out the best use of High Sentinels. Looks like Pelucranus may come into the red zone too. I think the thought process here is Corey saying, I need to maybe try to reduce the amount of devotion you have. Maybe I can force some blocks here. Tough to say what the best attack here is, though, in this gummed up board.
I would be surprised if attacking with anything besides the High Sentinel yielded very much.
Corey's hand's not great right now either.
For those of you unaware, this is also a very math-intensive deck.
Yeah, that's actually really the hardest part with the deck, I think, is the amount of mana that you can generate and how you want to use it.
There's also spots where casting stuff, because of Dictos, is either a free roll or even a rebate sometimes.
And what's also weighed into Corey's decision right now is he has a copy of Banishing Light in his hand. Mm-hmm. So now he has to figure out what to take down on Cecchetti's board, which he has a lot of options, and how to attack here, and how he thinks Cecchetti's going to block if Pelucranus is involved. And it looks like he might just be going after Nissa with both creatures. We'll get confirmation on where these attackers are going as soon as we know. They're both going to Cecchetti.
So this is lethal.
Cecchetti's doing some math and saying, okay, well, what can I do about this? How much damage can you possibly deal?
Well, the other thing is, you know, Daniel needs to figure out, am I chump blocking Pelucranus or by making some sort of effort to get it off the table this turn?
It looks like he's going the chump blocking route with carry added. It doesn't seem to be much of a punishment for that. Corey looks like he may have a High Sentinel's activation here.
So moving that token up over to the manifest creature does pump the High Sentinel.
So High Sentinels is a 5-power creature right now. Cecchetti's down to 4. But again, he can kind of go wild with Master of the Unseen. He does have what looks to be enough white mana to do that. And he can generate quite a lot of mana. Corey going to play a Banishing Light now. My question is, what's the target? There are quite a few to choose from. He's going to go with Pelucranus.
Yeah, I think the goal here to make it as prohibitive as possible to take care of the High Sentinels.
Sure. Pelucranus will be the draw here for Daniel, we believe, because there is a very real opportunity that in the upkeep, he says, manifest that and unmorph it.
Because at this point, Daniel's really digging for one of his white removal spells, Glare of Heresy, Valorous Stance. There's a lot of good ones, so he can churn through his creatures here in a look to get, in an effort to get more looks at one of his spells.
There's that option. There's just also the option, as Nick knows, is the top card of the deck, which is a very important draw for him, of just doing this on the upkeep. He's got mana floating right now, and just unmorphing, he'll gain 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 life.
Yeah.
go up to 14. And that's why the damage racing is, it's very tough for Corey to do. Because now he does get to unmorph this. And Nykthos, again, being on top of the deck means that this isn't, you know, his entire turn. He gets some other stuff to do now.
And the nightmare scenario here is that Daniel is able to keep, if you're on Corey's side, is that Daniel is able to keep this Nissa intact,
yep,
generate more mana, and then the ultimate becomes an issue with Pelucranos wearing down a bunch of your board.
Now, Force is on top of the deck. Nykthos was the draw. Now, Cecchetti's going to do a bunch of math because he drew Nykthos. He gets to redeploy Nykthos as he'd like. He can untap lands with Nissa, the two forest, activate the Nykthos, and maybe gun down some stuff here. All while being at 14, so he doesn't have to worry about lethal, really. And I think that's what Cecchetti's doing right now, is he's doing the math and seeing, is it possible maybe I even kill you this turn? He's going to gain 2 life, go up to 16. Sitting really comfy now.
I mean, Corey's shields are totally down besides a 3-3.
Now, we can't forget Pelucranos can't attack.
Yeah. But this is also generating, I guess the plus has already been used.
Yeah.
So not capable of generating a 4-4 this turn. But even just if the high sentinels are taken care of, the resource advantage that Daniel has at this point is just huge.
Yep. We'll see if he wants to get in the red zone or not.
I think so. I think he's in a position to potentially close his game out over the course of 2 turns.
Hydra looks like it has some interest. Corsair doesn't look like it's going to be attacking any 3-3s, so there's 6 points of damage. Cecchetti will bring Baumeister down to 18,
and
that'll be it.
You and I were kind of talking about this on Corey's last turn, the attack at you for not lethal in lieu of going after Nissa did not seem great given Daniel's ability to gain so much life, and now we're in this spot. And now Corey just passing the turn back. And Daniel with just a huge edge on board, huge edge on total resources.
Land will come in there and Windswept Teeth. And there is a huge edge in resources, as you mentioned. Genesis Hydra on top.
And Corey may be able to hold off for a couple of turns, but keep in mind that we're 2 turns away from Nissa's ultimate, which, given the way the board looks right now, is also going to be a lethal move.
Taking time bombs from a couple different places.
Right. And at any point Corey starts to threaten back, Daniel can just sort of turtle up here, start using Master of the Unseen, get a cushion, and hopefully wait for a big draw like Sabertooth or Genesis Hydra or so forth. So he's got a lot of control over the course of the game right now.
Force will come in. Corsair will actually be positive life here. And Hunt the Hunter is on top. Corey going to take a look. And that one's actually not bad right now. Nissa going to tick up and untap some lands here for some mastery activations. So the Hunt the Hunter is going to be, looks like, turn face down. Now, Plains will be the next card. But if you're Cecchetti, you're not in much of a rush.
Yeah, he's got a huge advantage in resources right now.
You can just pass the turn back. Now, Corey looks like he's going to activate Nykthos and maybe generate a little bit of mana and some Master of the Unseen activations. But he's just so far behind at this point. I'm not sure he has a card that he can use to catch up. With Cecchetti at 19.
Yeah, the problem is that, you know, Corey kind of took this position of damage racing at this point or trying to take an aggressive angle. And, you know, that's not going to work from the stage just because of the life total and Daniel's ability to sit back, defend himself, and gain life if that turns out to be the appropriate play.
I was mistaken, just the passing of the turn. Cecchetti will do some manifesting. Planes will be turned
Down or up, however you want to consider it. It's going to be face up because Courser's in play. So, again, we've seen this interaction quite a bit from these players playing Green White Devotion this weekend. Looks like Elvis Mystic may be the draw, if Cecchetti's comfortable drawing that. And it looks like he is. Top card of his deck now is a Peligranos. He'll play a Forest, trigger the Coursers, I imagine. And it might be Nissa's ultimate that actually gets the job done here.
Well, I don't know at this stage because Corey himself is turtling up to the point where I'm not sure that a sea of 4/4s will get the job done over a reasonable time frame here, but.
Yeah, 4/4 Tramplers.
No, it's fine, but Corey can also block pretty well too.
Sure. There's Blucranos. That'll be morphed. Here's Wishwood Elemental. I just think if we get into this situation, if you're Cecchetti, it favors him because, you know, he can find Teamer Sabertooth. He's got better draws in this situation.
He's got a big advantage for sure. The question is just, does Daniel at this point feel like he has inevitability and can take zero risks because there's no chance Corey can catch up, or does he feel like he has to make a move? And I guess he feels like he either has to or it's safe enough.
Well, that should answer your question. He wants them all, or at least most of them. Search your library for any number of basic land cards, put them under the battlefield, then shuffle your library. Those lands become 4/4 elemental creatures with trample. Hey, he gets to gain a bunch of life with Courser.
Oh, sweet.
That's pretty neat.
Combo deck. Really not that many basics in the deck.
That was a tame Nissa activation.
20 points of power is like, I don't know, that's a lot, I guess, but not.
Gain 10 life, 20 points of power,
relative to what's going on in these sort of games. I mean, that's fine, but that's no big turn. It's whatever.
The fact that is fine and no big turn is really something. I'll tell you that much. I think Cecchetti might just be passing here. I'm not sure if anything else is great to do, which is kind of an absurd thing to say, but yep, send it over.
I thought that it's possible that because it's essentially free, he would have sent in the Peligranos that turn because Corey probably just chump blocks it, and I think Daniel's plan is likely to just unmorph the next Peligranos. But, you know, at this stage, if Daniel misses out on one chump block, again, I don't think it's going to make or break anything. And he may just want to be as, you know, as defensive as possible.
Yeah, maybe since there's a Nykthos activation here, you count the devotion to green right around 9 in play. We could just see end of turn, flip up Peligranos, lose the other one, go animal.
Yeah.
Just looking for a way to break through. Go back Corey's way. A Genesis Hydra, the draw.
I mean, I don't know how much he has to get out of this jam, but that's going to be his starting point.
Yeah, I mean, you have to imagine, if he could Genesis Hydra for anything in his deck, what would he be looking for? I guess is the question.
The problem is I'm not sure there's any real individual card. I mean, I don't mind High Sentinels in this spot. I'm not sure Daniel can cobble together a lethal attack next turn and you can start doing some really powerful things with your mana, but I just don't know if there's any huge, huge hits left.
Yeah, I just don't find High Sentinels being an impact card right now. I just don't really think it does very much.
It forces Daniel's hand a little bit to start trying to attack.
I guess. I mean, Corey's not working with that much mana. He can gain a ton of life with the Master of the Unseens. I don't think that a 3-4 flyer, you know, if it was a 10-10 flyer, I don't think I'd care. I just don't think it does a ton. I'm not saying Corey's without any outs in this situation. I'm just not entirely sure what they are. There's a Hydra. He's gonna take a. Okay, there's. We'll find out if it's good right now.
Yeah. This is more of an issue of I'm not sure if this is good, but I'm pretty sure everything else is bad.
That's completely fair. So it's a 6-7 right now. 3-4 base power and toughness, and three creatures in play with +1/+1 counters. With the ability to put some more counters places. So oddly enough, we thought it was going to be the sideboard games that were shorter.
Yep.
Than game one. Game one was actually a pretty short affair. This one taking much longer.
Well, it's the absence of the Sabertooth. If Daniel finds that, we're going to be back in the same spot we were in game one.
Yeah, I think so too.
It still takes some time, but it's the writing's on the wall.
Master of the Unseen activation. And then maybe an unmorph, maybe not. Top cards of Voyaging Seder. That's a big one. That lets him go from 60 to 90, I guess.
It's funny just because mana is still kind of a bottleneck, just because when both players have so much and are able to do powerful things with all that mana, you need to have that much to catch up. So the Voyaging Seder looks like it's overkill, but it's not.
No, it actually just matters in terms of what Pelucranos is able to do. Cecchetti's going to gain some life here. It's like 13 of it. Can't forget that those forests up there with the die, well, those are from Nissa, so those are creatures too. Now Cecchetti's untapping. And he has actually two copies of Master of the Unseen, so excuse me. 28 life. Pardon me.
Don't want to shortchange the man.
I do not. I have to make sure everything is clean and accurate. On the upkeep, we might see a manifest here. And we will.
And I like Daniel being, you know, still going about his business doing this. Because it is important for him to unmorph creatures when he gets an opportunity to do so. Since, really, as far as we can tell, the only thing Corey is playing towards is trying to damage race with High Sentinels. So every time he gets a small creature and an opportunity to unmorph it on the cheap, that's a ton of life. It means that where Corey appears to be trying to take this game, it won't work.
Valor Stance on top of the deck. That is an answer to the High Sentinels, in case he does need one. Nykthos was the draw for the turn.
And there's only two copies in the list. One's already done.
There's an Elvish Mystic. And Cecchetti has the ability to activate Nykthos, which he will be using those lands that are creatures up there from Nissa. To maybe do some unmorphing, to maybe do a Nykthos activation. We'll see.
Yeah, I thought going ultimate with Nissa was about trying to get some power into play, but I think that going ultimate with Nissa is just, this is five lands and Nissa can only untap four.
Yeah.
So it's +1 mana.
Eventually I'll kill you with the lands, but for now,
right.
I need some mana. Some people saying they don't like the green-white devotion mirror. What's not to like? Bunch of mana, big creatures, big effects. This is magic, baby.
Well, I think when this becomes more prevalent, you know, and after this weekend, it's going to be all over the place. I think you're going to see more people having real game plans for the mirror.
Oh, yeah.
You know, right now it feels like this weekend these decks are trying to just, yeah, I'm just going to overpower you. That's sort of what the plan is here. There happens to be a team receiver tooth in one of these decks. It's a huge deal. But people, I think, can come up with more cohesive plans than that.
Oh, Gatherer is open for many people right now. They're looking for answers to the mirror. Here is another Nykthos. One way to crack open the mirror? Big old Pelucranos activation.
Yeah. But you can't play five, so...
That's true.
It's not going to... Not going to really inform too much about how people are building their decks, but I do think there's room for a more cohesive plan than just hope my stuff's bigger and badder.
Looks like we have 20 mana floating. Cecchetti confirming just how big High Sentinels is, which, again, currently a 6-7. Could get a little bit bigger since there is 4 mana available there for Corey. Could work its way to a 7-8. Want to make sure he does fight accordingly. It looks like it's going to be a fight for 9. And he'll divvy some things up here. I think he says 8 at the High Sentinels, 1 at the Elvish Mystic.
Yeah, just get another mana creature out of the deal.
Yep. And lower the devotion a touch.
Yep.
Yep. Pelucranos wins that battle.
And High Sentinels now no longer a factor in this game. Those
are. There are 0 of those left. Valor Stance is now going to be turned down. That's a morph. Next card is Elvish Mystic. Cecchetti will pass the turn back. 89 is 17. As we go back Baumeister's way.
That's why damage racing is fraught with peril.
Yep.
And now we're really only waiting for Teamer Sabertooth or Genesis Hydra for Teamer Sabertooth. And again, it's going to take a bit of time, but I think Daniel is going to be able to get this done.
This is the situation where I do believe Corey's now on an offer.
Yeah.
I don't think there's an out to get out of the situation. He can't interact with Daniel's board in any meaningful way.
He also just isn't generating a ton of mana right now.
Yeah.
Like, he has some mana, but Daniel's approaching all the mana that he can desire.
Yeah, and you can see Corey even a little frustrated now at this point. His 2 High Sentinels may have been his attempt at a Mirror Breaker this weekend, but Daniel actually has the real one in Teamer Sabertooth. Having a flyer is obviously good, and being able to divvy up +1/+1 counters and all that jazz, but... The Sabertooth being able to just loop Pelucranos, as we saw in game number 1, is just too much to overcome. Yeah.
So Tessin Tactics is another card that Daniel's drawing to that probably results in a kill as well.
Yep. Another Nykthos now. It's too much mana for him to handle.
Well, he doesn't have anything right now to really do
with it. Yeah, he doesn't have anything to do with it right now.
He needs one of his action cards.
Yeah. And that's just another just smooth interaction of this deck is, I don't have any action cards? Well, I'll manifest over and make sure that I find an action card.
Right, which is just burning through a ton of his dead draws and getting him faster and faster to one of his big action cards.
Yeah.
And Daniel, I think, coming to the same conclusion that we are, which is that this board state is basically indecipherable for the purposes of, can I make a regular attack?
And Corey's at 17. Daniel has, oh, boy.
He's got 40 power in play or whatever. Like, maybe there's an attack here, but you can also just hang back and just wait.
He has a 14-14 Pelucranos, a 6-6 Genesis Hydra, 5-4-4 Trampling Elemental Forest, a bunch of manifest creatures in play. Some Coursers, some Elvish Mystics. Your turn.
Right. It's not like attacking is necessarily wrong. It's that attacking is too hard to figure out.
Yeah.
And he knows that he eventually wins the game by not attacking.
Yes.
So just hang tight for a little while.
Eventually, I will find Teamer Sabertooth. Eventually, I will find another copy of Pelucranos, and I will destroy everything on your board.
It's 8:30. The restaurants will probably be open at 9:30.
Yeah.
You just hang back and wait for a couple more turns.
It's Miami. They're open all night.
Right.
Whisperwood Elemental. A mere annoyance at this point.
Right. It's one of the most powerful cards very early on in the game, and at this stage it's just another thing.
Windswept Teeth will be manifested thanks to Master of the Unseen. Cecchetti trying to get closer to something that matters. Ding-a-ding-ding.
Ring-a-ding-ding-ding-dong. There we go.
Teamer Sabretooth is not the bottom card of Daniel Cecchetti's deck. And he's going to put it into play manifest style. Next card will be a Windswept Teeth. I think he's got enough to unmorph it too, and hey, let's gain some life. Because what kind of green-white devotion mirror would it be if a player wasn't at least triple digits?
Right. The game is barely started. I mean, yeah. 91 life is like the game hasn't even started yet, you know?
I prefer accuracy. 129, oh baby.
Mm-hmm. And Daniel needs to make sure that he's still has access to 2 mana through all this, so nothing funky can happen to the Sabretooth.
Yep.
I think he's fine. Probably.
from what you can see.
Right.
I think he's okay. Corey gonna manifest Whisperwood Elemental. Token, pass it. Well, those lands up there are always there.
Right, the 4/4s. Yeah. I forgot. Sure.
They're kind of hiding out up there on a rather cluttered commander board.
This would get you kicked out of a commander game. This isn't even a commander board.
Oh, you think so?
This is not even a commander board.
You can't play commander this way.
This is 2 people sorting out their collections.
Certainly not okay in Tiny Leaders.
Oh, no. You
can't do this.
No, you cannot. I mean, Genesis Hydra still plays, I guess, but...
I suppose.
Nykthos probably quite a bit less powerful.
Genesis Hydra, the top card of the deck now. Plukinos was returned back to the hand, so you imagine Cecchetti's going to redeploy here in just a moment as he plays the land. He's going to gain some life thanks to those coursers that have been played since day number 1.
And here we go. The slow but certain decay of Corey's board.
Much like game number 1. First, you start with the Whisperwood and some Mana Accelerants, then you take care of the Morphs, then you take care of his life total, which is not very high this game.
Yeah, only at 17. What happened?
The one thing Cecchetti needs to make sure of, and I'm sure he will, is just make sure he doesn't deck himself.
Yeah, as this has been a concern before. Now, Corey at 17, and with Daniel having the loop established, I don't think that's going to be a concern.
I don't think so either.
But you are right. It has come up before.
How you holding up? We need to get a pot of coffee going?
I wouldn't mind. I would definitely not turn it down. But I'm fine. I'm fine.
A little dark roast.
The beauty of Magic, at the end of the day, is that the possibilities are limitless. Is it good for the game to look like this all the time? No. But is the fact that this can potentially happen a small percentage of the time something that's good for the sense of the unknown? Yes. Hopefully, people find out the tech, at least for the mirror match, to expedite the process. But I do not mind this existing.
Thanks for interesting gameplay.
Well,
every once in a while.
Interesting is kind of weird here because I feel like this is almost a game of chess insofar as Daniel is so advantaged from just having the Teamer Sabretooth in his deck that a lot of the normal ebb and flow variance of Magic is kind of pulled out of the match. But there's definitely a lot of complexity going on. There's a lot of interactions.
Well, here's an interaction right now, which is Whisperwood Elemental, you need to die. Going after that and a couple morphs.
pretty big one, since we're reaching for the 20-sided die. Whisperer will be sacrificed. Couple manifest creatures are going to bite the dust. As you mentioned, the slow process.
Yeah, the slow but steady grind.
So both Whispered Elementals will bite the dust. Little manifest there. But this is how you crack open the mirror. And still, I am... Cecchetti's going to win this thing.
I believe so.
Slowly but surely, he's going to win this thing. And I am truly impressed that that group of players came with tech to beat the mirror. I am truly impressed.
This deck is a masterpiece. There's no doubt about it. Yeah. Even if this is challenging to watch at times, you do have to appreciate how well-tuned this build of Devotion is. Both of them, honestly. But the fact that one of them was prepared for the mirror match, that's going to result in a Grand Prix trophy.
Yeah. And it's just been, you know, again, Green-White Devotion was really the talk of the tournament for some time, you know, on the floor. We found out on Friday that, you know, the Star City guys, the Roanoke crew, were playing the deck, and they felt so strongly about it.
Yes.
And they just, and those guys are sure a lot of the time about what they're playing.
Not like this.
Not like this. Not like this, where they're just like, this is the deck. This deck is completely busted. You know, Ross Merriam switched over to this deck. Michael Major switched over to this deck. Brad felt very confident, as Brad oftentimes does, but Brad normally gets these things right when it comes to standard. BBD, CVM, Todd, those guys were all very, very sure this was the thing to be doing. And then, you know, I ran into Sam before the tournament began on Saturday. And I said, you know, Sam had recorded some videos with Devotion Strategies. And I said, you know, I'm playing green-white. He's like, yeah, duh. And I'm like, he's like, our deck's insane. And he was right, too. It's just theirs is a little bit better than Corey's and Brad's this weekend.
And you see Daniel now, he's not even bothering to do the manifest my creature inside the draw because the concern at this stage is getting decked. Nothing else is of concern. And we also saw this come up in the Sam Black v. Michael Majors match is at this stage, the only thing preventing Corey from dying is continuing to activate Mastery of the Unseen, gaining some life and generating some chump blockers. And that puts Corey at risk of getting decked if the damage doesn't do him in.
See Corey kind of looking around. It's almost like he's waiting to die.
Yeah, that's probably about right.
Yeah, he's got his brother and a couple of other people there you guys can't see kind of on the rail.
Just the sweet release.
Yeah. 26 green floating.
Been sitting here on life support for a while. Yeah. Just ready to move on to the next chapter.
Genesis Hydra looks like it might find a Reclamation Sage.
Yeah, take care of Mastery Unseen. Cut off that angle.
Yep.
Then go Duke Nukem on all Corey's creatures and then attack for what I can only pray is lethal.
Yeah. Which we believe to be 25 points of damage.
I think we got it. Yeah. I'm not totally sure, but I think we got it.
Oftentimes we refer to things as the sleeper hold and other wrestling moves. I'm not entirely sure which one this is.
Right.
The crowd isn't even trying to rally anymore.
Right.
The good guy.
They're just begging for it to stop.
Yes.
Get this guy out of the ring. Enough damage has been done.
Looks like Corey is considering maybe a little manifest action here.
Gotta get a little life on your way out.
You do. Can't take it with you.
It's true.
Whisperwood Elemental. Ha-ha.
The plot thickens.
It does thicken. Like a roux. And there goes Master of the Unseen. Cecchetti with a board of absolute nonsense at this point, as we have now hit the 100th minute in the match.
Wasn't sure we'd get here, but there we are.
Saber, Tooth Plus, Reclamation Sage. Yet another combo.
Yep. A deck full of them.
Yep.
Master of the Unseen will be manifested. The top card. Don't have a great look at it. I believe it's Plains.
I think Daniel might have hit the this is good enough portion of the turn. Maybe there's another play to be made, but
I've had my fun.
Whatever.
Yep.
Take your turn.
Ah, Temple, plenty on top.
You've heard the term start to take a foothold in the Magic community of going wide, typically reserved for. You have a 5/5, so I want to make 5 1/1s in attack. Daniel is going wide in a much more literal sense.
Yep.
Just literally generates so many permanents that you encircle your opponent's board.
You know, one thing I can respect, Corey, just playing on.
Sure. You know, whatever. He's having a good time.
Yeah.
Finals of a Grand Prix is a big moment. It's possible. I guess it's still possible Daniel gets decked. Who knows? So
hey, this is a match.
Play on.
This is a match he will never forget. And certainly a weekend he will never forget.
Yeah.
You have to imagine.
Absolutely.
The likelihood of him winning this game very, very low. Does not look like he will be the Grand Prix Miami champion. But to play against your brother in the last round of Swiss, to get conceded to come back to Magic after taking a rather long hiatus, no buys, unable to acquire buys in the grinders on Friday, and not lose a match until the finals.
And listen, playing this game out is a testament to the human spirit. Because we know.
We know when you would have conceded. We know. You've conceded to a turn two kitchen Finks before.
Yep.
Just have moved on.
Mm-hmm. Writing was on the wall.
Your concession stamp of approval. We know what you are capable of as far as playing a game is concerned.
I might have conceded if it was Dan. About to win the Grand Prix.
Yep.
So, good on him, too.
Yep.
Applause all around. Yep. I don't know.
Get ready for a third one. It looks like we have a Polygranos activation here. There's a lot going on. A lot of mana being added. We've got 30 floating. Cecchetti is picking a spot here.
Mm-hmm.
It seems.
He's been, this is just a sequence on loop that we saw last game.
Yes.
Corey can't really break out of it, especially now with Reclamation Sage, so Banishing Light's no longer an out.
Yep. Some arbitrary large number. This, and I imagine all of the manifest creatures?
That's usually the order you want to do it. I mean, if Corey flips up some into creatures in response and gets a couple replacements, that's no big deal, but get the Whispered Elemental off the table. Get a bunch of the tokens off the table. It's also possible Daniel's just had lethal for upwards of 7 turns now. I don't know.
Well, if he clears things out with this attack, I think he can just say, okay, everyone. Because what's the worst that could happen? My opponent attacks me back with everything. I'm not going to die. I think we've gotten to that point of the game.
The other out here is it may be physically impossible for Daniel to Alpha Strike. Like, he just can't actually turn all of his cards.
Sure.
So Corey can hope to deck him, I guess, assuming that he can't actually attack.
Test his dexterity. Can he actually turn everything? Pretty small board.
Okay, it looks like we made some inroads.
Yep. Seems as though it might be safe. One less creature. Is Cecchetti feeling it? Oh, yes.
All right. We will test the waters, I suppose, with the 2020.
Okay.
We'll start. Okay.
Just one.
Like the block.
Just one.
Probably don't need to carry added.
Yeah, you know, mana not really much of a bottleneck at this right. point, I think, for Corey. So just one here from Cecchetti. And now we see where the encroachment has really come in.
Right.
Now Cecchetti establishing dominance. He will unmorph something, I think.
Yeah, he's saber-toothed. He's getting back his manifested Hunt the Hunted.
That's a genius play. I love that.
Yeah. Okay, so.
Yep.
Next turn is looking pretty promising for an Alpha Strike.
Maybe. Again, I think we might just see the one.
Just put him in the abyss?
Yeah, just the one. That's it. He tapped out. Daniel Cecchetti has done it. He has defeated Corey Baumeister 2-0. And ladies and gentlemen, he is your Grand Prix Miami champion. Congratulations to him.
Yeah, very well deserving. This deck looked incredible. Highlighted by the fact that there was a mirror match here in the finals, and Daniel with just one key card, a lot of the same components bouncing off of each other, but Teamer Sabretooth, that was the whole finals.
Yes.
And I don't know what the other matches looked like throughout the course of the day, but that card was the entire match.